had some amount of experience in that particular field will be able to answer the remaining 20. So in your hands will be 80 probable good questions, which about 60 will be easily for you to answer, and they will be generally be repeats. Even the options of the repeats will not change. There will be that easier repeats. Okay, A option B, option A, option B will be the same thing. There'll be no change in the bits. Okay, those kind of things are very important, and you should not make mistakes in those kind of small bits. So our main aim of this class, or our main aim of the session, is to highlight those common bits first, and also take you insight into the remaining 20 that I've told you, the important, the concept oriented bits and all. So when it comes to breast, I think in a paper of about 100 questions, maybe you may get about five to six questions from breast, a very, very important topic. I hope you know how important the breast is. Even in the MS level, you would have at least for your exam, at least about few questions. And also you would have easily about maybe even your practicals, you'll be having a question on breast or case on breast. So I would like to start off with breast. If you have seen that over the last few years, the important questions that have come, 80 to 90% have come from what is called as breast malignancy. Breast malignancy does play a very vital role, and you should know in and about at least even the latest trials. There are even questions on trials. I want people to be more interactive. I want people to unmute themselves, talk about whatever they know, or just stop me whenever you feel there is anything that you're not able to understand. Because here, I'm telling you, the 60 bits that are very commonly asked, I'm going to discuss over and over again, maybe repeat it 3-4 times. About the remaining 20 bits that I've told you, which contains a lot of concept and all, we're going to understand the concept of breast cancer and its management, the commonly asked questions, and the remaining 20, what we normally do in our practice daily, and some important questions related to imaging and all, we'll be discussing one by one. I hope it's clear for everyone. I hope everyone can hear me. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay, I'm fine. Right, thank you. So I'll be starting off with first the anatomy. So the most of the questions in anatomy that come up, they are in the form of all the following are true, or all of them are true except. Please read each and every word in the question. Make sure that you underline the word except before you answer the question. Make sure you highlight the word except before you answer a question, because that is what is going to change the entire answer. And whenever you are answering a question, don't try to blindly go with the answer. Please don't try to blindly go with the answer. Instead, you eliminate each of the four bits, each of the four options. I think you will have ample amount of time to answer each and every question, because you almost get about 1 to 2 minutes of a time, or at least 1.5 minutes of time per question. Make sure that you do not just blindly go with the answer. Try to eliminate the remaining three options to put the right answer. If not, you will be in trouble, especially in present situation where all the questions are like, which are all the following except, which are the following are not except, all the following of the statements are false except. So these words really make a lot of difference, a lot of difference in the English, etc. So the first slide that I've given to you, playing right now, is the slide regarding the anatomy. The first few slides are anatomy. Here, the first line was asked at least 15 to 20 times. Breast is modified sweat gland or upper pain gland or a mammary gland. Should always remember this. You will never get in an option sweat gland or apocrine gland. You will either get sweat gland or apocrine gland, one of the option. You will not get both options in the same thing. Okay. Agar dono bhi option aaya to, you will get marked if you answer both. Okay. It's a modified sweat gland or apocrine gland. It is present in both the sexes, but it is rudimentary in males, and it is well developed after puberty in females. So these three were previously asked questions. There were options from one of the questions, which says which are all the following are true. And they were one of the options, except all the following were true, except these were one of the options. That's the reason I put up this slide. Then next, extent. This is the first two points that you can see, they are present in the superficial pectoral fascia, and the superficial fascia splits to enclose the breast. This lines are very never asked before. They probably can be asked. Okay, it is the splitting of this pectoral fascia that will enclose the breast tissue. Okay, so the pectoral fascia will split open and enclose and becomes an anterior and posterior lamellae, where it will enclose the breast tissue. And the extent that you can see vertically and horizontally, vertically it extends from the second rib to sixth rib, from the clavicle to seventh and eighth rib. That is the vertical extent. Horizontally, it extends from the midline or lateral bottom sternum to the mid axillary line. Always remember, there was once a question which was asked. Midline was given as the option, but there was another option that was really bad. So even sometimes some of the examiners can give midline as the option. The actual horizontal extension is from the lateral border of the sternum. But if you get midline as one of the option and you have another option which is really wrong, please go with that wrong option. Midline is partially correct. I wouldn't say it's totally correct. It is partially correct. And remember, whenever you have a question, you'll be given four options. Always remember, out of the four options, if you have to answer one correct options, you have to answer the question, the option which is highest percentage of being correct. Okay. So let's say you have a question and the four options are there. Option number one would be 20% correct. Option number two would be around 60% correct. Option number two would be again around 60 to 70% correct. But option number three would be 80 to 90% correct. So you should choose the option that has got the highest chance of having correct in the percentage. Okay. It does not mean that the fourth option has to be 100% correct. There will be exceptions. There may be exceptions, but the option that has got the highest chance of being correct will be taken. If you see this picture, this is a very important thing. The extension is from second to sixth rib, which you have seen, consists more of fat and the adequate blood supply. The base is formed by pectoralis major muscle. And then you have the fascia here, which will encroach the breast tissue into anterior lamellae, and the fascia divides into anterior and the posterior lamellae, where it encloses the breast tissue. And you have the blood supply to the breast that is coming from the bed of the tumor. This blood supply has got very important factors, very important reasons why we'll discuss about it slowly as we come along this thing. Then high yield paper, again, you should know what constitutes the floor of the breast. Floor of the breast is the muscle or the tissue under which the breast tissue lies. You should remember it overlies these three particular muscles: pectoralis major, serratus anterior, and upper fibers of external oblique. Okay, upper fibers of external oblique, pectoralis major, and serratus anterior. These are important because two things. Number one, when you have the option or when you have the question which says what forms the chest wall involvement in carcinoma breast, is not involvement of pectoralis major. It has to be ribs that has to be involved. Okay. And second important point is it lies over these structures. So these muscles are highly prone to get infiltrated, and they form an important landmark when it comes to the anatomy point of view, where you may have an option says all the following are true except, and they give one option pertaining to pectoralis major forming the base of the muscle, or serratus anterior or external oblique forming the base with the approximate locations. And one more important, this is how the breast tissue looks in a developing, in a during lactation. You can see all the lobules are increased in size, and during non-lactating period there's more of fat and some amount of dense fibrous tissue with still rudimentary or yet to develop or non-functional ducts and lobules. So this is a very important slide, a very, very high yield slide. All the following are true about few statements or few muscles according to the breast tissue. You should know about this. So pectoralis major, the question that was previously asked about pectoralis major was, it forms, which are the following? It forms the major muscle posterior to the breast. Most amount of the breast is in relation to the pectoralis major muscle. That is an important point. And all the lymphatics and blood sub breast, they pierce through this muscle and then go into this thing. In a previous, you should know about this, in a radical mastectomy, it is totally removed. You probably would know about it. And next, anterior fascia is fascia anterior to this thing, to pectoralis major, is removed in radical mastectomy. You also know about this. So pectoralis major, there were four, these are the four previous points that were asked, and you should know about them, and I think you know about them. So pectoralis minor, it is a very important landmark. Pectoralis minor is a very important landmark because it divides the axilla into three particular levels, where we'll be discussing about them. They're called as Berg's levels. This name was not previously asked. This can be asked right now. What is Berg's levels of lymph node classification? We will come out according to that. Then this is the pectoralis minor muscle is most important, and where the modified radical mastectomy is divided into three different types based on this handling of this pectoralis minor muscle. So how pectoralis minor muscle is handled up and how it is, we'll have a discussion about it. Serratus anterior, the most frequently asked question is this one, responsible for ringing of scapula in the long thoracic nerve, that was previously asked. And latissimus dorsi, the important point that was asked was, it forms the posterior margin, posterior wall of the axilla. Fascia is continuous with the axillary fascia, and the anterior body, the latissimus dorsi becomes the latermost part of the dissection. And this is the muscle that is used normally for forming the LD flaps or reconstruction. So this table or this page, I have given as a very important thing, because there are questions pertaining to the muscle. All the following are true except, all the following are not true except. So there's a combination of everything that comes into these things. And these are the common points asked in that. That's the reason I have put this up. And I think this plays a very important role. And one question from anatomy from breast, 1 to 2, is more important. And even the surgical anatomy will be very much important. So quadrants of the breast, you know, these are the quadrants of the breast. There's central quadrant, upper inner, upper outer, lower inner and lower outer. All of them play a very important role. And you should be able to differentiate and know where the tumor is. They have a very important role because of blood supply and other factors. We will discuss about them slowly. Now, axillary tail of Spence. This axillary tail is a small extension that we know about. It was first given by a surgeon, a Scottish person by name James Spence. Not asked previously, but just kept in mind. Then it's the posterolateral extension of the breast into the axilla along the lower border of pectoralis major. You should see it's along the lower border of pectoralis major, and it is the posterior lateral extension of the breast tissue. It may extend deep through the deep fascia into the axilla, and sometimes you may see any bulge or something and you may mistake it to be some axillary lymph node, where we normally do an ultrasound, and ultrasound will differentiately tell it is a breast tissue and not a lymph node. It is clinically slightly difficult to differentiate between axillary tail and Spence or something, especially in a menstruating or a active female. But what we need to do, what we need to know about is what basic things can be asked as a question. So here we are going to discuss only in terms of what can be asked in the exam. And these are the commonly terms that are asked. It extends, once the question was asked, it extends on the lower border of, it extends on the, and the question which was the following statement was false. It extends onto the anterior surface of the muscle was asked. No, it normally extends onto the lower surface, lower edge of the pectoralis major. That was a wrong statement. Okay. So keep this in mind, that the axillary tail of Spence extends into the lower border of the pectoralis major muscle. Then nipple. Nipple is also a very important line, a very important point. Most important is because of the reconstruction. This is not asked previously, can be asked. If you take the suprasternal notch, if you take the suprasternal notch and the breast tissue, if you draw a line from the suprasternal notch to the nipples on the both sides and join these two lines, this forms an equilateral triangle. And the approximate dimensions normally is between 21 to 22 centimeters. So this is an equilateral triangle that is formed when you join a suprasternal notch and nipples of both the breast. And this forms a very important equilateral triangle. So this was not asked previously, can be asked. This is very important in order to maintain the level of reconstruction. So whenever you are doing breast reconstruction, you should make sure this quadrilateral, the equilateral triangle, is maintained so that there is symmetrically or symmetry that is maintained in during breast reconstruction. Hence, this is the paper itself was taken from a breast reconstruction paper. Hence, you should know this point about nipple. And it generally is composed of dense collagenous connective tissue and where all the lactiferous ducts open up. And that's where from the milk and all. And you also have a lactiferous sinus that is present below this thing. It is surrounded by hyperpigmented skin, and the skin pigmentation varies from person to person also. This is at the level of the fourth rib. This is also another important point that was asked. Okay. So in this nipple, there are about 15, each breast contains about 15 to 20 lobules of milk producing glands. And they have a epithelium, they open up into a ductule, and these ducts open up just below nipple area complex. And they are where from where this milk is produced, and then milk is expressed out into this thing. So the important structure you should know about here is what is called as lobular and ductal system. So this forms what I'm showing with the marker. This forms a lobule. This is a lactiferic duct. And here it forms a sinus, which opens into the ampulla and which opens into the nipple. So whenever you have two things, this is a lobule and this is a ductule. Any tumor that is arising from this or the junction of duct and lobule is called as lobular carcinoma or lobular carcinoma in situ or lobular histopathology. Any malignancy that is arising from the duct per se is called as ductal carcinoma, ductal pathology, ductal carcinoma in situ, anything is duct. So any lesion that is arising from the lobulo-ductal complex is lobular. Anything that is arising from the ductal complex is ductal. So this is the very important point that you have to understand. And so any of the tumors, so what happens now is when there is tumor infiltration into these ducts, you can see these ducts, right? So these ducts, when this tumor infiltrates, it will cause cicatrization or pulling or whatever you call as fibrosis, where the nipple can get easily involuted inside. So that is the cause of nipple retraction. Okay. And any of this tumor tissue can enter into this ducts, and here it may get calcified and it forms what is called as linear calcifications, because the shape of the duct is various thing. So linear coarse calcifications are another sign of malignancy. That is because the tumor cells can get what you call, they get calcified into these ducts and then they form these malignancies. So whenever the duct is involved, the duct can cause fibrosis and or because of malignant infiltration, and they cause nipple retraction. And also duct may cause another thing, what is called as calcification of these ducts because of the tumor cells. These calcified tumor cells may later on show up what is called as linear calcification or Cole's calcifications. If I'm going fast, please stop me somewhere so that I'll know the speed I need to correct. If I need to correct, please stop me. Okay. So this is in nutshell what is going to happen in the breast per se. So this is another important thing. So nipple retraction is because of this. This is another important point called a suspensory ligament. It was first given by Ashley Cooper back in 1840s. So this, if you can see these go from the, this is actually the enclosure of what is called a pectoralis major fascia. So the pectoralis major fascia divides into two leaflets, the anterior and posterior leaflets, where the breast tissue is present in between it. And there is a connection with the fibrous septae between the anterior and posterior leaflets. This is what is called as suspensory ligaments of Cooper. And when you have involvement of this suspensory ligaments of Cooper, you can see that this ligament can get shrunken or this ligament can get fibrosed, where you see in the form of puckering or nipple discharge, puckering or dimpling. Okay. But the point that you should remember is this fibrous tracts that are present and they're getting fibrosed. These fibrous tracts are part of breast tissue and not part of skin. So the dimpling is caused because of involvement of these fibrous tracts. And because of that, what happens is there's dimpling and puckering of this skin that is noted. And hence, it is not the involvement of skin. It is the involvement of breast tissue per se. It is the involvement of what is called as breast tissue. So breast tissue involvement can present as puckering and this thing, and it is not skin involvement. So remember one thing, Ascherian Cooper's ligaments are part of breast, not a part of skin. And because they are involved, you get what is called as this concept of puckering or dimpling. And because there is puckering or dimpling, it does not mean skin is involved. Skin involvement is only in form of either a satellite lesion or skin ulceration or pudorange. So these are the three things that are mandatory to demonstrate skin involvement or T4B lesion. Okay. In TNM staging, T4B. We will come into that soon. So in young, when these fibers are very, as you grow old, these fibers or these ligaments become lax, that leads to ptosis of the breast. So this is another high, very, very, very high yield paper. And the point here is you're supposed to discuss or you're supposed to know about the various arterial supply. You should see, if you can see the picture, these are all the various arteries. I'll tell you how to remember each of them so that it's easy for you to remember in the exam. So if you can see this blood supply, it is coming laterally from both the sides. If you see, it's coming from medial side and also from the lateral side. And you have posterior side, the aane wale vessels, the vessels that come from posterior side. So you have superior medial, superior lateral, and the posterior side vessels. So these forms very three important pillars. So you have a superior medial pillar, you have a superior lateral pillar, and you have an inferior pillar. So these three or these three parts form a very important point when you talk about reconstruction of the breast. We'll discuss about reconstruction a while later, but now these are the important things. So you should remember the most important artery is the thoracoacromial artery, which comes here. And the axillary artery divides and gives these four branches. See, always remember, you have what is called as lateral mammary and medial mammary. Two mammaries, the one from lateral side, the one from medial side. That is first thing. Second thing is when it comes from the axillary artery, you have the superior thoracic, then you have the thoracoacromial and radial thoracic and subscapular arteries. Whereas from internal thoracic, you have perforator branch from the second, third and fourth. These are the very important structures because they give even perforating branches to the skin. You would have probably heard of what is called as deltopectoral flap. Deltopectoral flap also is based on these perforator branches. If you have seen a case of MRM, on the medial side in the intercostal areas, you will be getting a very big blood vessel that will bleed. So that is a perforating branch that supplies to the breast tissue. Okay, so internal thoracic is from perforating branch from the internal thoracic artery from second to fourth intercostal spaces. Okay, so these forms the main, and posteriorly also you have some branches from the epigastric artery. So when you have superior medially you have from the internal mammary artery, laterally you have from thoracoacromial artery and its branches, and also from the axillary artery and its branches. Inferiorly you have from the epigastric artery. If you have any questions or anything that you want to ask, you can put up at least in the chat box so that I can see the chat box and ask if there's anything, or probably discuss there's anything required. Okay. Feel free to ask anything. I'll repeat the entire concept about these things again. Okay. Right. Going to the next point. So lymphatic drainage, quite a lot number of questions are asked about the lymphatic drainage. That's because blood, the half of the questions or even the most important things about the the drainage of the lymph nodes and also malignancy and all these things, they are very important. And so basically the point you should remember is the breast tissue is from ectodermal in origin, and most of them will flow along to the breast, along to the axillary lymph nodes as per the overlying skin. So overlying skin will direct the lymphatic flow. Okay. So these are the various stations that you should know. Axilla forms about 85% of the drainage. They are again divided into groups, anterior, posterior, central, lateral, apical, and interpectoral. We'll discuss about them one by one. Intermammary is seen about 10% of the patients. Most of them, the tumor that is present in the medial aspect of the breast, they form about 10% of the tumor. And others are very rarely seen, supraclavicular. Should remember a point that supraclavicular lymph nodes do not form a part of the axillary lymph nodes. Okay, do not form a part of axillary. And supraclavicular lymph node involvement, is it metastatic are non-metastatic? Can anyone tell me? Supraclavicular lymph node involvement, is it metastatic or non-metastatic? Cephalic delivery pectoral nodes, posterior intercostal lymph nodes, subdiaphragmatic and subperitoneal. So supraclavicular lymph node involvement is not considered metastatic. It is still N3C. I have a question for you. Thank you. Yeah, nice. So I have a question for you. Suppose I have a small T2 N0 lesion in the breast, and opposite side, I have one small 2x2 centimeters mobile lymph node on the opposite axilla. What stage am I dealing with? The question is, if I have a small tumor on right breast and I have on examination an axillary lymph node on the opposite breast, so what is the stage of tumor that I am dealing with? Can anyone tell me? Yes, it is metastatic. Involvement of opposite axilla is metastatic. Only ipsilateral, if you have seen everywhere, it's all ipsilateral that will be involved. So totally the axilla has got about 20 to 40 total lymph nodes in number. Yeah, please. Anything? All good? Yeah. So we have 20 to 40 in number. And these are the important groups that you should know and their approximate location. Anterior group is just posterior. They form the anterior border of the axilla, and they're just lying below the deep to the pectoralis major muscle, and posterior along the subclavius muscle, laterally along the axillary vein. Central is what is present in the axillary fat. And if you go more medially, medial to the pectoralis minor muscle, then you have the apical lymph nodes. So if you can see here, the pectoralis minor muscle is removed, and these are the groups of lymph nodes that you should know. Here is the anterior, here is the posterior groups. These form along the axillary vein, it's the lateral. All these three will first drain into the central, and then this will drain into the apical. So apical is also considered a part of infraclavicular nodes. Infraclavicular lymph nodes is what stage in N? Can anyone tell me? Infraclavicular lymph nodes is what stage in N? Central consists of both N1 and N2 group of lymph nodes. N3A, perfect. And then you have the lateral group, posterior and anterior group. So this is what is the lymph nodes involvement. So these are other group of lymph nodes. They are very in number. Most of them are present in the middle, this thing, near the parasternal area. You're in a clinical examination, if you see parasternal area, you will have a direct tap. And anytime you see any dullness, or anytime you see it is dull, you say it is, which it will be most of the time dull. You cannot clinically, it's very difficult to palpate unless until they're very, very big. Most of the time they are noted by only what is called as investigation. And presence of internal mammary node is N2, minimum of N2. Okay? Then you have the rotor nodes. During MRM, you will be removing, while doing MRM, you will be removing these pectoralis lymph nodes. And then you have the supraclavicular nodes. So this is what I was telling. This question was not previously asked. Axillary lymph node levels are called as Berg's levels of classification. Can be asked right now. This is a fresh question. So pectoralis minor is the muscle that will divide this levels of axilla into three levels. Anything that is lateral to the pectoralis, if you see, this is the pectoralis minor muscle. Anything lateral to the pectoralis minor will become level one lymph node. Anything posterior to pectoralis minor will become level 2 lymph node. Anything medial to pectoralis minor will become level 3 lymph node. So whenever you have the axillary dissection, what was initially done was very important. When you have this Halstead era and Patty's mastectomy era, they, in order to clear these level 3 lymph node, they used to remove this pectoralis minor muscle and help in clearing of all the lymph nodes. So what there was noticed is there was a high chance of what is called as upper limb edema, and later what it was very disheartening and very difficult, and later even Stewart-Travis syndrome like angiosarcoma was all developing because of this extensive lymph node dissection. And what they have now seen was level 1 and level 2 is more than adequate. So when you have to clear level 2, you need not remove the pectoralis minor muscle. You can just retract the pectoralis minor muscle and then keep in place. Hence, because of this, the term of what is called as Oshin class modification of pectoralis minor muscle has come into play. I hope you have understood what is this level 1, level 2, and it is called as Berg's axial lymph node staging. So these are the common questions that we have noticed so far, or we see in what is called as axilla and axillary treatment per se. And also pertaining to anatomy, these are the questions that are commonly asked. So